In Christian marriage. The covenant of marriage was established by God, who created us male and female for each other. With his presence and power, Jesus graced a wedding at Cana of Galilee, and in his sacrificial love, gave us the example for the love of husband and wife. Ed and Pat come to give themselves to one another in this holy covenant. I ask you now, in the presence of God and these people, to declare your intention to enter into union with each other through the grace of Jesus Christ, who calls you into union with himself as acknowledged in your baptism. Pat, will you have Ed to be your husband, to live together in holy marriage? Will you love him, comfort him, honor and keep him, in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, be faithful to him as long as you both shall live?
I will.
Ed, will you have Pat to be your wife, to live together in holy marriage? Will you love her, comfort her, honor and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, be faithful to her as long as you both shall live?
I will.
Who gives this woman to be married to this man? Let us pray. God of all peoples, you are the true light, illumining everyone. You show us the way, the truth, and the life. You love us even when we are disobedient. You sustain us with your Holy Spirit. We rejoice in your life in the midst of our lives. We praise you for your presence with us, and especially in this act of solemn covenant, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. scripture reading comes from John chapter 2, verses 1 through 11. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the celebration. When the wine ran out, Jesus' mother said to him, "They don't have any wine." Jesus replied, "Woman, what does that have to do with me? My time hasn't come yet." His mother told the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Nearby, there were six stone water jars used for the Jewish cleansing ritual, each able to hold about 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, "Fill the jars with water," and they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Now draw some from them and take it to the head waiter," and they did. The head waiter tasted the water that had become wine. He didn't know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. The head waiter called the groom and said, "Everyone serves the good wine first. They bring out the second-rate wine only when the guests are drinking freely. You kept the good wine until now." This was the first miraculous sign that Jesus did in Cana of Galilee. He revealed his glory, and his disciples believed. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Well, many of you, I'm sure, watched the royal wedding a couple of years ago between Prince William and Kate, the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge. The wedding set the bar fairly high for romantic weddings. Words like fairy tale romance and storybook romance were used frequently to describe their lives and their relationship and the event, and I'm sure that's true. But guess what? They've got a small baby at home now. And even for a prince and a princess, with probably so many servants around to do so many things, it's probably safe to say that life isn't exactly a fairy tale or a storybook anymore. It's just too much work. But guess what? Love, real love, true love, Christ-like love, is always hard work. We don't emphasize this enough, I'm afraid. We want love to be easy. That's why so many songs, movies, TV shows, novels, plays, and poems celebrate falling in love. Now, falling in love is awesome. That wonderful feeling of not being able to get enough of the person with whom you're in love. Just being with them makes us feel great. But do you see the problem? Falling in love, as great as it is mostly about what's in it for me. What do I get out of it? There's a lot of ego, a lot of self-centeredness in that. For a successful marriage, we need real love. In fact, we need to listen to Mary, the mother of Jesus, in today's scripture when she told the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." We servants of Christ must also do whatever Jesus tells us and do whatever Jesus shows us about love in his word. And what does the Lord tell us? To forget about us and what the other person is doing for us. To forget about our wants and needs and focus on the wants and needs of the other person. Is that possible? The love that a parent has for a child comes pretty close, I would say. The love that a parent has for a child, it reminds us of this kind of Christ-like love. Because we parents give and give and give to our children. And then, guess what? We give and give some more without thinking for a moment what's in it for me. We give and give and give, and moms and dads out there, isn't it totally worth it? Now, some of you have teenagers, you're not so sure right now. But someday, even those parents will say, yes, it's totally worth it. But let's face it, parents, we can't always achieve this high standard of love. And I'm thinking right now of something that Bill Cosby said that his own father would say to him when he was a child and he was misbehaving sometimes. His dad would say, son, I brought you into this world, and I can take you out of it. And it don't make no difference to me, because I can make another one look just like you. The point is, our love, even at its best and truest, is still conflicted. We can't love others completely, because there is always at least some small need that looks to the other person to fulfill. There's always at least a little bit of selfishness or self-interest in our love. By contrast, God needs nothing from us. God is complete and perfect unto God's self. So when God loves us fully, completely, because unlike us, there's not even one small part of God that's thinking to himself, what's in it for me? Jesus Christ, who is God, expresses this love in the fullest way imaginable on the cross, giving of himself completely out of love for us. This is the very meaning of the love that is described throughout Scripture. I pray that God's Spirit would inspire and empower this kind of self-giving Christ-like love within you both, even as you nurture romantic love and friendship in the days and years ahead. The love that unites these two in marriage is surely one of God's greatest gifts to us, and we celebrate that gift today. Let us pray. Eternal God, creator and preserver of all life, author of salvation, giver of all grace, bless and sanctify with your Holy Spirit Ed and Pat, who come now to join in marriage. Grant that they may give their vows to each other in the strength of your steadfast love. Enable them to grow in love and peace with you and with one another all their days, that they may reach out in concern and service to the world, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And I'll start with you. Repeat after me. In the name of God, I, Ed, take you, Pat, to be my wife, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, until we are parted by death. This is my solemn vow. In the name of God,
in the name of God,
I have taken you, Ed, to be my husband, to have and to hold, from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, until we are parted by death. This is my solemn vow. These rings are the outward and visible sign of an inward and spiritual grace, signifying to us the union between Jesus Christ and his church. Bless, O Lord, the giving of these rings, that they who wear them may live in your peace and continue in your love all the days of their life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Repeat after me. Pat, I give you this ring as a sign of my vow, and with all that I am and all that I have, I honor you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now repeat after me. Ed, I give you this ring.
Ed, I give you this ring.
As a sign of my vow.
As a sign of my vow.
And with all that I am.
With all that I am.
And all that I have.
And all that I have.
I honor you.
I honor you.
In the name of the Father.
In the name of the Father.
And of the Son.
And of the Son.
And of the Holy Spirit.
And of the Holy Spirit.
The rings symbolize the joining together of these two in holy matrimony, as will this sand. Both Ed and Pat are their own persons with unique personalities and gifts and abilities. But they're bringing their lives together in such a way that the bond that is uniting them can never be broken or separated any more than the sands that are being poured into this jar. You have declared your consent and vows before God in this congregation. May God confirm your covenant and fill you both with grace. Now that Pat and Ed have given themselves to each other by solemn vows, with the joining of hands, the giving and receiving of rings, and the combination of this sand, I announce to you that they are husband and wife. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, those whom God has joined together, let no one put asunder. Amen.
Amen.
Lord,
just as sure. Seasons were made for change. Our lifetimes were made for these years. So
consecrated the covenant of Christian marriage, that in it is represented the covenant between Christ and his church. Send therefore your blessing upon Ed and Pat so that they may surely keep their marriage covenant and so grow in love and godliness together, so that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace. Amen. God the Eternal keep you in love with each other so that the peace of Christ may abide in your home. Go to serve God and your neighbor in all you do. And to the congregation, bear witness to the love of God in this world, so that those to whom love is a present to you Mr. and Mrs. Edward and Pat Surrett.